I've always wondered why in movies and on TV a person's inner monologue has an echo. And why do electric toasters have a setting that burns your bread to the point where it looks like coal? Are there actually people who eat charcoaled toast? And why do rabbits never smile? What are they so annoyed about? And how am I going to start the next full English lesson? I know. I'll do a bit where I'm thinking about things in my mind. That'll be so awesome. Well, hello, my lovely, loyal World Wide Web viewers, and welcome to another full English lesson. This is episode 13. Some people believe that the number 13 is unlucky. Some people really fear it. The fear is called triskaidekaphobia. The fear of numbers exists in many countries. For example, in China, the number 4 is seen as unlucky, as the Chinese word for it sounds like the word for death. But let's not dwell on that too much, because I must get on with today's full English lesson, which, by the way, is a hot one. Right? Now. Can you see what sort of day it is here? Today is a hot day. It is a midsummer's day. This seasonal period is when the days are at their longest and quite often their hottest. A hot day can be described in many ways. It's a scorching day. It's scorching hot today. It's a sweltering day. To swelter is to feel uncomfortably hot. It's baking hot today. It's burning hot. This sort of weather makes me feel all sweaty and sticky. If you stay out in the sun too long, you will burn. Your skin will turn red from the sun's ultraviolet radiation. Too much exposure to harsh sunlight will literally burn your skin, which can lead to serious health issues later. Ironically, exposure to UV light is necessary for the production of vitamin D2 in the human body. So, a hot day like this can be described as hot, scorching, sweltering, dry, baking. The extreme heat is overwhelming, oppressive, harsh, and unbearable. Oh my goodness, I'm so thirsty. I feel parched. I'm gasping for water. To refresh yourself by drinking something cold is to quench your thirst. Your thirst is the need, and the drink is what will satisfy that thirst. We can also use the word thirst to show the desire to do something or to obtain something beneficial. You can have a thirst for knowledge, a thirst for social interaction. We can also use the need for food, hunger, as an idiom for want and desire. I hunger for your soft embrace. I'm hungry for success. Both hunger and thirst are often feelings that need to be satisfied. That's better.
Yeah.
Can you see what I'm holding here? It's something sweet and very easy to make. This is meringue. Meringue is a type of sweet food made by mixing well-beaten egg whites and sugar together and then baking it until it becomes crisp on the outside. A meringue can be eaten on its own or used as a topping for desserts, especially pies. The center of meringue tends to be soft and sticky, just the way I like it. This particular meringue has been coloured with strawberry juice and smothered in white chocolate, which means that I'm now in confectionery heaven. By the way, the word confectionery is another word for sweet things, such as chocolate and candy. They are both types of confectionery. There can be no doubting just how hot it is today. It is so hard to escape the heat. By the way, the word heat can relate to other things besides temperature. We can use heat as an idiom for danger or trouble. Let's wait here until the heat has died down. To feel the heat means to be aware of possible dangers or an approaching situation that might cause you trouble. We can say that the heat is on, which means that a tough situation is happening. Then there is things are really heating up now. This means that there is tension and maybe a sense of excitement in the air. To be in hot water means to be in serious trouble. Then there is a heat, which is a round in a contest or competition. A part of a contest can be called a heat. Congratulations, Mr. Duncan. You are through to the next heat. Do you know someone who is obstinate? An obstinate person is someone who refuses to change their mind about something, no matter how much persuasion they are given. The person stubbornly refuses to change their mind, even when there is very strong evidence or proof offered. That person will still refuse to accept what they are being told. They obstinately reject your point or idea. There is no point in trying to change his mind. He is as obstinate as they come. A stubborn, unmoved, fixed, adamant, immovable, pig-headed, persistent person might be described as being obstinate. When describing a difficult, unwelcome, or hard-to-change situation, we might use the word obstinate. The problems occurred after years of obstinate mismanagement. This is a much better place to be standing. If you want to escape the harsh sunshine, then you will need to find a nice shady place in which to hide from those nasty UV rays. You need to shade yourself from the sun whenever possible. A shady spot gives you relief from the sunshine and the heat. The word shady can also mean suspicious or untrustworthy. We can describe a person we don't trust as being shady. A shady character is a person who should not be trusted. A shady deal is an exchange or business deal that is being dishonestly carried out.
I have received an interesting question from Sharif, who lives in Egypt, and asks, is it acceptable to use capital letters in writing? The use of capital letters all the way through a word or sentence when writing a letter or typing an email or comment would appear to be commonplace. Though, generally speaking, the use of capital letters is not acceptable in formal writing. However, informally, we might use capital letters as a way of emphasizing stress in a sentence. When you want to show anger or rage in writing, it is very tempting to put some or all of the words in capital letters. If you want to draw attention to a word, you might put it in capital letters. This might be acceptable if done in general correspondence, like an email or a forum comment. But even then, you might find it frowned upon by many. Of course, capital letters are still used at the beginning of names, brands, and sentences. But to use capital letters all the way through a word might be off-putting and leave the reader with a negative feeling about the person who composed it. If you really want to add stress or emotion to a sentence, then why not use an exclamation mark instead? There are many ways to keep yourself cool on a hot day. A quick way of doing this is to use one of these. This is an electric fan. A set of blades rotate to produce a flow of refreshing air. Very nice when you need to feel cooler without making much effort. A fan can also be something you use to cool yourself off with by waving it whilst holding it in your hand. Any large flat object can be used as a fan, such as a piece of cardboard or a magazine, or even one of Mr. Duncan's old flip-flops. On second thoughts, I think I'll stick with the electric fan. It's much less effort. It's time to take a peek at another buzzword. A buzzword is a word or phrase that is popular during a certain period or is used frequently. Today's buzzword is radical. The word radical as an adjective means something relating to or affecting the fundamental nature of something. To change something from its original form to something more extreme or profound might be described as being radical. Forming an inherent and fundamental part or nature of someone or something. Some radical differences exist between those who follow the news and those who don't. A medical procedure that will be completely curative is radical. Something characterized as being a departure from the traditional. It may, in some instances, prove to be innovative or progressive. A radical approach. A radical alternative. A complete social or political reform supporting an extreme idea or concept might be described as radical. As American slang, it is sometimes used to express very good or excellent, although this use is now seen by many as out of date and old-fashioned. As a noun, the word radical is a person who advocates others to push for a complete change or move away from the current methods of thinking. Radicalism is the noun that names the act of being radical. To convey radical ideas to others is radicalization. To radicalize someone is to persuade them to follow a way of thinking that to others might seem unacceptable or extreme. Then there is radicalization, which is the noun that names the action of radicalizing someone. Black shoes and socks with shorts. Oh, what a fashion faux pas. They appear so odd together when looked at from afar. Shorts with black shoes and socks should never ever be seen. Even if you squint, the sight is still quite obscene. Black shoes and socks with shorts, please be off and make it quick, as those black shoes, socks with shorts are making me feel quite sick. Do you ever brush something under the carpet? No, I'm not talking about doing the housework. In this case, I'm talking about trying to forget something or to pretend that something does not exist. The idiom brush under the carpet means that you would rather forget that something bad, unpleasant, or difficult to deal with has occurred or will occur. You try to brush the bad thing under the carpet. You try to make it go away by consciously denying it. You want the thing to go away, so you try to brush it under the carpet. There is no point in you trying to brush this under the carpet. Let's just brush all this bad news under the carpet, shall we?
Sadly, that is all I have time for today. Yes, another full English lesson has come to an end. Don't worry though, because I will see you very soon for full English number 14. Yes, it's true. This is Mr. Duncan in a hot and sweltering England, which just happens to be the birthplace of the English language, saying to you, thanks a lot for watching me teaching you. And of course, until next time, ta-ta for now. Why not check out my YouTube playlists featuring all of my English lessons?